Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Gildan Media presents an unabridged recording of I Will Hold, the story of United States Marine Corps legend Clifton B. Cates, From Belleau Wood to Victory in the Great War, by James Carl Nelson. Narrated by Sean Pratt. October 3rd, 1918. He has already spent one night sleeping almost atop the bodies of dead men, French and German, dead for days and weeks, and thankfully unseen now in the blackness, though there was no mistaking their odious putrid smell. And so, when the whistles shrilly pierce the early morning air, it is something of a relief to be up and off, even in the first rays of daylight, at least until he and his men are greeted rudely by the whistling of Minenwerfers and the zip-zip-zip of machine-gun bullets, and soon enough the familiar, dull, slapping sound of metal encountering flesh and bone, the accordant screams of the wounded, and the muffled coughing of those already dying. Quickly out of the trench and up the hill, he pushes past blasted dugouts and through and over the wire, red with rust after 4 long years of war, but still a prickly impediment to reaching the crest. Before too long, he is almost to the top, almost there, through the wafting gray smoke and the squeezing pup-pup-pup of the machine guns, and through the long brown grass and the shell holes pocking the hill like vacant black eyes, and past the blue-green bodies of the dead, Marine and German. And still, he pushes on, almost laughing, almost floating from the sheer bloody wonder of it all. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Artillery rounds plop at random here and there, sending black geysers of soil high into the air, and more men fall. Keep going. Keep going past deep redoubts and blasted crumbling trench lines in which dead men lie splayed in their deathly innocence, and through the wafting acrid black smoke that stings the eyes. Keep going. Men scream. Men die. He finds himself almost laughing. It is not so horrible to him, not so bad. He has done something like this before, at Belleau Wood and Soissons, and he knows it is something he will do yet again before this war is done. His right hand oozes sweat, coursing slippery and wet down the handle of his 45, and more streams from his brow under his deeply dented helmet. A shadow at his side tumbles forward and lies still. Keep going. Keep going. Almost at the top, he sees one of them racing away. He follows instinctively at a run and fires, almost laughing. Marines all along the line now reach the main trench and begin the work of the bayonet, or swing their rifles like baseball bats, or fall on the enemy with fists and knives even, if that is what it takes. A German officer suddenly appears from the dank recesses of a dugout. They eye each other, just for a split moment, and pistol to pistol, as if they were gunslingers on the streets of old Laredo, each waiting for the other to draw. Suddenly the German fires. He fires back. The German tumbles into his hole, a look of surprised horror on his face, and a deep red stain spreading over his heart. Keep going. And as he does, he takes it all in. The chaos and the shouts and the shots and the smoke and the chattering guns and the wails of the wounded. He feels somehow impervious, almost immortal, as he moves now along the hilltop trench, tossing grenades and shooting until the brow of the massif is finally taken, and long lines of the enemy slouch down the hill, even as ever more Marines come up. It is almost comical sometimes, he thinks, this war-making, these bloody, glorious, horrible, life-taking battles, sometimes almost make him laugh. God, he loves this war. God, he loves this awful, tragic, soul-grinding, terrible, wasting, wonderful war. Lucky. Faster, goddammit, faster. Bleak figures bundled against the snow, and leaning forward into the sleety wind, blanketed horses pulling the wagons of street vendors, gnarled immigrants wrapped in blankets and shoveling ice-clogged sidewalks, Gaggles of truants, heaving snowballs from tenement rooftops crisscrossed with a cat's cradle of wires. His taxi passed all of these things on the morning of January 22, 1918, speeding from Herald Square for the harbor, where the transport, the USS Henderson, either was or was not waiting at anchor. And as the taxi raced on, 24-year-old Clifton Bledsoe Cates, fretted in the back, chain-smoking furiously, and ignoring all of these varied sights of lower Manhattan, his mind spinning gloomily as it obsessed on one overriding concern, that his career in the United States Marine Corps had died even as it was aborning, and he was finished. His ship had been slated to leave port more than an hour beforehand, and he knew if he wasn't on board when it sailed, he'd be court-martialed for desertion. There was no question about it, he would recall with a comfortable laugh years later. The old Henderson, carrying the 2nd Battalion of the 6th Regiment of Marines, had sailed from Philadelphia on January 20th. The next day it heaved to in New York Harbor, and the officers on board were allowed shore leave, with the understanding they would be back on board by 8 a.m. So Cates headed to shore with his mates for the bright lights of the city. After some hours of carousing, he decided at 2 a.m. he'd had enough. A heavy snow caressed the dark night in rippling currents, blanketing the streets, and there wasn't a taxi in sight. So he took a room at the Grand McAlpin Hotel on Broadway and West 34th Street instead, and left instructions with the night clerk to awaken him at 6 a.m. He crawled into bed, not even bothering to take off his uniform. When he awoke, it was well past 9 a.m. I was frantic, he would recall. He raced downstairs to the lobby and paused only long enough to colorfully tell the hapless clerk some of what he thought of him, and then hurried out of the hotel, quickly hailed a cab, and was soon speeding toward the docks, hoping against hope that the Henderson would be there, hoping against hope that this new life he was learning to love hadn't ended abruptly on the streets of New York on this cold and miserable morning, hoping that he could rejoin his men before they sailed into a world war and endure with them whatever was to come in the trenches that split France like a heaving sidewalk crack. Faster, he told the hack. Faster! Certainly more veterans would come out of World War I more famous than Clifton Bledsoe Cates, some of them becoming heroes for great exploits performed over the course of a minute, 10 minutes, or a few hours. Some of their names would spill from the history pages in perpetuity. Alvin C. York, Cates's fellow Tennessean, was of course the most famous of these, and Sam Woodfill would have his measure of fame, as would Michael Mad Dog Ellis, Wildcat Marine John Joseph Kelly, Charles Whittlesey of Lost Battalion notoriety, and many others. Clifton Bledsoe Cates was not destined to share as bright a spotlight. His acclaim, such as it was, came not from one single act, single-handedly capturing 100 prisoners, bravely knocking out 12 machine guns with but a bayonet and a hand grenade, but for his body of work in World War I. He would be knocked out, knocked down, gassed, nicked, pinged and dinged numerous times, and still rise to lead men. He would, by force of example, show men what they could do, what they needed to do. His bravery, his pluck, his sheer bursts of illuminating optimism would shine daily in the worst of circumstances during the second half of 1918, from Belleau Wood to Soissons to Blancmont, and finally to the last days in the Meuse Argonne. And it would be no coincidence that his unit, the 96th Company, 6th Marine Regiment, would suffer more casualties than any other American company in the Great War. Cates did his work quietly, with almost unearthly confidence, and a dash of derring do. Ordered forward over and over again, he would lead his company into the thickest of battles, and against all odds, and though his men fell dead and wounded all around him, he would emerge safe and alive and sometimes even laughing, as if protected by some divine providence. Other Marines could only shake their heads in wonder at him. Cliff Cates, they all said, the luckiest man in the Great War. He would become one of the most famous of United States Marines, a Corps legend, and on his way to becoming the 19th Commandant of the Marine Corps in 1948, he would lead a platoon, then a company, then a regiment, and finally a division into battle. It was a somewhat unlikely destiny, perhaps, considering his origins were pastoral rather than martial to much degree. It had been expected that young Cliff Cates, born to some wealth at a long-held family cotton farm known as Cates Landing, Tennessee, at a spot where the broad Mississippi River dips south and then violently north again as it meanders toward the one-time earthquake epicenter at New Madrid, Missouri, would someday become a yeoman farmer and businessman like his father and grandfather, or an attorney handling civil cases instead of ammunition boxes under a shingle to be hung in Memphis, Knoxville, or maybe Nashville. But as with some of the nation's other notable military commanders who came from the soil, Clarence Huebner comes to mind, as do Dwight Eisenhower and Ulysses S. Grant, Cates would find his calling as a lifer in the United States military. A world war that had not even been a shadow as Cliff gambled among the fields and along the riverbanks of the Mississippi as a boy would provide the setting for a permanent career change and provide as well the battlefields on which he would display the utter fearlessness and cool-headedness that would make him a Marine Corps legend. Anderson Cates, his grandfather, had been born in North Carolina, but like many restless souls of the time, meandered west, arriving in northwest Tennessee in 1836 with but $2 to his name. He went to work as an overseer on a local plantation, and by the late 1840s had saved enough to purchase the riverfront acreage that would come to be known as Cates Landing. There, the pioneer Anderson Cates finally put down roots, taking a wife, Alice Jane Emily Peacock, in August 1848. She soon died, and he remarried, this time to Susan Box, and together they farmed and produced 9 children between 1851 and 1868. A biography would note that while Mr. Cates was a Methodist, he was also a Democrat, among whose ranks were, as the historian James McPherson would put it, yeoman farmers in the upcountry or backcountry who disliked city slickers, merchants, banks, Yankees, or anybody who might interfere with their freedom to live as they pleased. Anderson Cates's fifth child, Willis Jones Cates, was born in 1860. He would spend his life improving and prospering from his father's hard work, operating 3 cotton gins, farming the land, overseeing a general store at the Landing, and also serving on the board of directors of the Farmers and Merchants Bank in Tiptonville, 10 miles south. Willis took as his wife a local girl from a prominent family, Martha Maddie Darnall Bledsoe, whose maternal grandfather, Henry McKinney Darnall, at the age of 30 in 1838, had been made captain of the local militia. From then on, he was known in accordance with peculiar Southern tradition as the General, despite declining a commission with the Rebs, and despite being just one of only 2 men in Obion County to vote against secession. With one hand on the plow and another on a ledger, Willis was regarded as one of Lake County's most stolid citizens. While not hasty in reaching a conclusion, his mind, when once made up, was unchangeable, his obituary in the local paper would read. Modest and retiring of disposition, and slow to put himself forward, nevertheless he possessed that force of character and strength of purpose that enabled him to face every situation squarely and to do justice though the heavens fall. The first of 2 children born to Willis and Maddie Cates, a daughter Catherine, would arrive in 1896. Clifton Bledsoe Cates was born at the family's riverbank home on August 31, 1893. As he grew, his cherubic face and soft features belied an inner strength developed through a childhood that rivaled that of Tom Sawyer, as his parents allowed young Cliff Cates plenty of room to roam, and plenty of time to explore the woods and the waters of the Mississippi, in which 6-foot-long catfish still lolled at the bottom, and where the canebrakes and old-growth forests spreading east and south were still rife with targets. Davy Crockett, years before, had hunted the same land, and on one single day, it was said, he killed 25 black bears within the borders of Obion County. Wild hogs, leftovers from Hernando de Soto's early explorations of the area, still posed a threat to a young boy, and water moccasins and the remaining bears and other fauna also taught any youngster wandering the woods to keep his wits about him at all times, or suffer the consequences. Cliff Cates roved. He hunted. He trapped. He fished the river like a latter-day Huck Finn, and he learned how to work a shotgun, with dubious early results. On one occasion, he nearly blew his head off when he placed his weapon on a bottom fence post, and it discharged upward, singeing his very eyebrows. On another, he endured a whipping at the hand of Willis Cates after shooting the prized family hog that he may have mistaken for the wild variety. Attending first a country schoolhouse, he was bright but not particularly studious. His mind and body often roamed from his reading and recitations and mathematics to the lures of the nearby wilderness and Realfoot Lake, a favorite of his uncles Council and Reuben. Though they farmed nearby, each year they spent a month drifting the lake's shallow waters, trapping and hunting and fishing. They also consorted with a rough-and-ready brand of outdoorsmen who were a law unto themselves, as a newspaper story from 1893 would have it. The lure of the wilderness, and his testing of himself within it, would remain constant themes in Cliff Cates's life. Combat, at heart, is a test of one's courage, will, and stamina. And the battlefield itself is a wilderness of dangers known and unseen, a place where heightened senses, learned responses, and sometimes plain old instinct could be the difference between life and death. The wilderness and its tests imbued in the young Cliff Cates a lifelong self-confidence and an independent streak that on a few occasions was rubbed raw against the strict discipline of the military. But his carefree ramblings, his life among the Indians, as it were, also imbued in him a certain cocksureness, while his family's modest wealth and his parents' preaching instilled in him a generosity of spirit and, perhaps oxymoronically for a core lifer, a compassion that would help him quickly endear himself to the man who followed him into hell on many a battlefield. While the roving and exploring only hardened his body for the grueling ordeals that a war would shortly bring him as a young man, Cliff's parents no doubt fretted over other traits he would exhibit throughout his life. He loved a prank. He loved a joke. He loved to swear and gamble, and eventually he would learn to love a drink, not to mention a smoke. He displayed a certain laconic, devil-may-care approach to the world that would confound his professors and betters. Though not rebellious, from an early age he displayed a certain savoir-faire that was a tad out of step with the more staid and, yes, aristocratic conceits of his parents. Willis and Maddie would try to wash some of the Huckleberry Finn out of the once and future heir to Cates Landing by sending him at the age of 12 to far-off Nashville to attend the Branham and Hughes School for Boys, and thence to the Missouri Military Academy across the Mississippi River in Mexico, Missouri. There, his instructors furthered the task of, in effect, trying to wipe that silly smirk off Cliff's face and instilling into his studies some needed discipline. The medicine eventually took, at least to some degree, as Cliff finally applied himself in the classroom and on the parade ground. "Up to then, I had never done much studying and work," Cates would later concede. "I went up there with my mind made up to settle down and work hard. I went in for everything. And I did make good." After graduating from the academy, Cates, in 1912, enrolled at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. Having learned some discipline of mind as well as body, he indulged the latter with baseball, basketball, and football, taking the underappreciated position of guard on the Volunteers team, long before helmets were de rigueur. Playing football brought his love for the test of battle quickly to the fore. Cliff was the lightest of the guards, but by all odds the most enthusiastic and hardest-fighting lineman on the squad, one of his teammates would remember. "I do not believe he started a single game, but he played a lot. While playing and practicing, his face was always lit up, like that of a small boy with his first football." But it remained difficult for Cliff Cates to sit still in a classroom. Classmates would recall that Clifton Cates loved his fun, and it sometimes appeared he didn't want his studies to interfere, as one newspaper would recount years later. In fact, he cut so many classes at Tennessee that one of his instructors once gave him a sweeping mock reintroduction to the class when he reappeared after a long absence. A newfound appreciation for the fair sex may have run interference with his schoolwork. The still easygoing, laconic Cates had developed an easy way with la femme, and his letters from the time are peppered with the names of numerous belles, among them Elizabeth Rose, Helen Petway, Ruth Stiles, Mildred Sisson, Joan Rayner, Margaret Devereaux, and Phoebe Walker. While on summer breaks from the university, he worked the land and docks around Kate's Landing, and also tended to the beacon that, at night, guided riverboats through the perilous New Madrid bend of the Mississippi. During the course of one summer, he invited a good friend, his fellow Vols athlete and future Philadelphia Phillies manager, Tommy Doc Prothrow, to stop by Kate's Landing while Thompson was working as a purser on one of his own grandfather's riverboats. Prothrow stayed in one of the Kate's guest houses, and it wasn't long before Prothrow and Cliff's 18-year-old sister, Catherine, became an item. They would wed in October 1917. Despite his ways with and interest in the ladies, no such matrimonial urges pestered Cliff. When his schooling at Tennessee ended in the spring of 1916, he instead returned home with a law degree to help his mother, Martha, tend the farm and cotton gins, his father having passed from cancer at the age of just 52 on June 20, 1912. He would pine on occasion for his father and fret over his mother's being left alone on the homestead after his sister married, but he had a life to live too, and was making plans for a career in law at exactly the same time as the United States was stumbling toward war. A world war had been playing out in bloody fashion since August 1914, but there's little evidence that Cates had paid much heed. Like many in the United States, he was content to keep the war over there, to let decrepit nations slug it out with one another while millions bled and died. Given his training at the military academy, he may have had the odd military interest in the conflict, strategy-wise. Certainly he'd read of Washington's struggles at Valley Forge and victory at Saratoga, Lee's brilliance and Jackson's daring at Chancellorsville, of the Greeks at Thermopylae and Wellington at Waterloo. But if Cliff Cates had any military ambitions at that point, he left no record, and it wasn't until early 1917, when events began spiraling toward a U.S. declaration, that he, like many other young men of the time, seemed to even sit up and take notice. That February, Germany, the natural enemy should the Anglophile United States enter the fray, increased its campaign of submarine warfare and began sending U.S. ships carrying materiel for the Allies to the bottom of the Atlantic. Then it was revealed that Germany, too, had inveigled to have Mexico stir things up on the U.S. border should the United States declare war, promising to Mexico the return of California, New Mexico, Arizona, and Texas, should the Germans come out victorious. The insidious nature of the latter revelation stunned and angered a nation that, prior to this, had regarded the European conflict with little more than passing interest. It was then that men such as Cliff Cates took the world more seriously and began to think about the eventuality of their country entering the conflict and what their part, if any, might be in that. And when war was finally declared on Germany by the U.S. Congress on April 6, 1917, the world came to the doorstep of men like Cliff Cates, men who had until then led a certain sheltered life, and were certainly privileged in his case, considering that at the time just 1 in 30 U.S. men aged 18 to 24 was enrolled in the nation's colleges and universities. When the United States entered the World War, Cliff was back in leafy, genteel Knoxville studying to take the state bar exam and prepare to begin a quiet and prosperous life as a lawyer. He had by then accepted that his fate was to lead his clients through the maze of the courts. But the world outside Cates Landing in Knoxville had finally piqued his interest, and he had begun to consider entering the service. Which one? He did not yet know. He felt an urge to test himself now as a man, as the woods and fields around Cates Landing had tested him as a boy. And like thousands and thousands of young American men, he felt the need to do the right thing and be part of history, no matter how terrible the history that was playing itself out in the grimy and bloody trenches of the Western Front. Still undecided over what to do, one afternoon in April 1917, he ran into John Ayers, whose father, Brown Ayers, was the university president. Cates asked him whether his father had had any calls from the military about students entering the service. His friend said he had not. Cliff told him, "Put my name down if things change." 2 weeks later, he again ran into Ayers, who told him his father had been contacted by the United States Marine Corps, which was seeking candidates to fill 8 second lieutenancies in the Marine Reserve. "Do you want to apply?" Ayers asked. Cliff looked at him blankly. "The Marine Corps?" he asked. "What's that?" What is a Marine? Part 1. The first taxi blew a wheel rounding a corner on that barren and cold New York morning as the future commandant of the U.S. Marine Corps raced to see what his future might hold, a world war or a Navy brig. And so he leapt out, paid the hack, and flagged another. Fog had crept in and buried the streets and obscured the city's buildings, making driving hazardous, dangerous, but he didn't care. "To the docks," he told the driver. "Faster!" Finally, the hack slammed to a stop at the harbor's edge, and a lone figure in uniform jumped out and raced to the edge of the pier. The harbor was a miasma of mist and sleet, and he couldn't tell if the USS Henderson was still at anchor. Crestfallen, Cliff Cates tried to resign himself to his fate, which did not look to be pleasant. "Here's one bird who will be held as a deserter," he thought. At last, a British ship went by, and he asked for a lift out beyond the soup. After plying the waters for some time, he looked up and saw the old Henderson. Clifton Bledsoe Cates managed to somehow slip aboard unnoticed, and he did not reveal his close brush until many years later. "I would have been court-martialed for desertion if the Henderson had sailed on time," he would say. "There is no question about it." It would be several more days, in fact, before the ship would exit the harbor. Cates found his quarters, heaved himself into a bunk, and reflected on his close call, an event he would never forget. That evening, officers were again offered overnight leave, but Cliff Cates wasn't about to try his luck one more time. "No, sir," he replied. "Not me. I'm not going." Clifton Bledsoe Cates had taken up the challenge of enlisting in the United States Marine Corps, and then took and passed a rigorous test aimed at officer candidates. When the word came that he had been accepted, he was in the middle of the state bar examination. He stood up, walked out of the hall, and never looked back. He quickly discovered, to his own surprise, that he had been born not to be a lawyer, but a Marine. He had been born to lead men into desperate battle across wide, open killing grounds, up hillsides strewn with machine guns and barbed wire, and the dead and the dying, and through acrid, thick air singed by war. But standing on that shady sidewalk in Knoxville, Tennessee, on that spring day in 1917, the Flatlander Cliff Cates would have little knowledge of the Corps. What it was, or who they were, or what deeds Marines had performed in relative obscurity in the far corners of the world. "The Marine Corps," he had wondered aloud. "What's that?" Prior to Belleau Wood, prior to Blancmont, the Corps had operated almost as a secret society, a sparsely populated fraternity that sent its members to exotic places of which many had never even heard. The men who went to these places were two-fisted, hard-living salts who considered themselves married to and subject to the Corps and little else. They were tough, profane, proud, and lifers, most of them. But they were more than just that. One Washington Times writer would, in 1919, describe a Marine as a trained athlete, a picked man, a he-creature with muscles and a jaw, whose motto is kill or be killed, and who believes with all his soul that no man on earth can lick him, and it comes pretty near to being so. The United States Marine Corps was created in 1775 as a branch of the Navy, and over the years its men had served on ships and at lonely outposts almost worldwide. Marines were men who have done about all the fighting under the American flag since the Civil War, another writer would say. Under all skies and climates, they are always at the point where they are needed, the skirmish line, the police patrol of our government, the guardians of national dignity and American citizens, wherever there may be the threat of trouble. The young American with an ambition for real adventure, with the wish to see and learn the art of war, has in recent years been commended to the Marines. If there is trouble, It means Marines to the front, first to get orders, first in motion, first ashore, first to fire. There is no finer body of fighting men in all the world, none more thoroughly seasoned or widely experienced. In other words, a Marine is a baby they send for when some country gets fresh and tries to go Republican, the Marine Winslow Belton Marshall would say. There never is any trouble. The revolutionists are buried in lots of 1,000 each. Once a Marine got wounded, he stumbled over the Porto Bananas Army on the way back to the ship. Porto Bananas. Indeed, the Marines had deployed in dribs and drabs in many a so-called banana republic, and had always worked with handfuls of men, not by regiment or even company. When national dignity or the interests of the nation's turn of the last century capitalists were threatened, Marines were sent for and pitched into the Moros in the Philippines, the Cacos in Haiti, the Spanish in Cuba, various rebels in Nicaragua, and the Boxers in China, among others. In the spring of 1917, much of the Corps was spread around the world, doing what its members always had done from Guam to Nicaragua to Haiti to China, and 100 other stations where one or two or half a dozen lonely Marines were stationed to watch out for American interests. Salty, tough, worldly, and cocksure, some of them should have become legends as much for their deeds as for their fantastical musical names. Smedley Darlington Butler, Littleton Waller Taswell Waller, Johnny the Hard Hughes, Hiking Hiram Bears, Albertus Wright Catlin, John Twiggs Myers, Presley Neville O'Bannon, Joseph Henderson Pendleton, John Archer Lejeune. And there were also a number of diverse people who ran curiously to type, with drilled shoulders and a bone-deep suntan and a tolerant scorn of nearly everything on earth, the Marine John W. Thomason would write. Their speech was flavored with Navy words and words culled from all the folk who live on the seas and the ports where our warships go. In easy hours, their talk ran from the Tartar Wall beyond Peking to the Southern Islands, down under Manila, from Portsmouth Navy Yard, New Hampshire, and very cold, to obscure bushwhackings in the West Indies, where cacao chiefs, whimsically sanguinary, barefoot generals with names like Charlemagne and Christophe, waged war according to the precepts of the French Revolution and the cult of the snake. They drank the eau-de-vie of Haute-Marne and reminisced on sake and vino and Bacardi rum, strange drinks in strange cantinas at the far ends of the earth, and they spoke fondly of Milwaukee beer. All could fight, however obscurely, protecting Americans from their own worst enemies, usually themselves, as the Marine historian George B. Clark would have it. Missionaries were saved in China, and large banking houses in New York didn't lose their investments in Haiti or Santo Domingo. Second-rate Latin governments that had recently overthrown third-rate governments were helped out of office with assistance from U.S. Marines. Their enemies were usually an illiterate peasant with, most likely, just a machete as the weapon of choice, choice because it was the only weapon available. Marines, Clark would add, were the chosen instrument of the United States State Department for a reign of terror in the Caribbean in the early years of the last century. Until quite recently, Nicaraguan mothers obtained their children's obedience by threatening them with being taken by Major Butler. That would be Smedley Butler, who would have concurred with Clark's assessment of the Marine role, but who had had a sort of epiphany after retiring from a glorious career that saw him earn 2 medals of honor while fighting from Tianjin, China, to Veracruz. He went on to write a book titled War is a Racket, and in one 1933 speech noted, "I helped make Mexico, especially Tampico, safe for American oil interests in 1914. I helped make Haiti and Cuba a decent place for the National City Bank boys to collect revenues in. I helped in the raping of half a dozen Central American republics for the benefit of Wall Street. I brought light to the Dominican Republic for American sugar interests in 1916. In China, I helped to see to it that Standard Oil went its way unmolested." Be that as it may, theirs, once in the Corps, was not to question why, but to do or die. And Marines, if nothing else, were doers and performers of deeds heroic and spectacular in their lonely and godforsaken outposts. Witness no farther than Gunnery Sergeant Dan Daly, whom Butler called the fightinest Marine I ever knew, manning that lonely solo outpost on a wall in Beijing and killing scores of Boxer attackers through the course of one long night. Witness as well his heroic action in retrieving a much-needed machine gun from a dead mule while under fire in a deep black Haitian swamp, each deed garnering him a Medal of Honor. Witness as well John Quick, who braved the fire of Spanish and American guns during a landing at Cuba's Guantanamo Bay and calmly directed a U.S. gunship's fire, thus earning the first of two Medals of Honor. Despite such heroics, the Marine Corps labored and fought in comparative obscurity for much of its history, operating not en masse, but in small units. The Corps numbered just 1,800 men at the outbreak of the Spanish-American War, and the forces which so often brought order out of chaos and turbulent lands and put to rout armies of rapacious revolutionaries were few in numbers, though mighty, like a squad of New York policemen quelling a riot. The 6th Regiment's first commander, Albertus W. Catlin, would write proudly after World War I. Americans have come to take it as a matter of course that a Marine should be able to do the work of 10 ordinary men, and the Marines have come to that belief too. Such hubris did not endear the Corps, which by March 1917 had been enlarged to 18,000 men, to the larger regular army. After war was declared in April 1917, the Marines' effort to send a regiment immediately to France was contested by the Army General Staff, who saw no need for a second army, and whose motto quickly became, "No Marines in France." George Barnett, Marine Corps Commandant, was told to go talk to the Navy. But the Corps had itself adopted a motto, "First to Fight." Determined to prove those words were more than mere rhetoric, the politically connected Barnett went above heads and behind backs, not only to win approval for a regiment of Marines to sail for France, but also to get President Woodrow Wilson to approve the raising of another 4,250-man regiment of Marines. And Congress in May 1917 increased the size of the wartime corps to more than 31,000. From its scattered forces across the world, the Marine Corps cobbled together a regiment, the 5th, consisting mainly of veteran fighters, but also a contingent of eager young Americans who'd been lured into volunteering with the promise of a quick trip to France and action. By mid-June 1917, the 5th Marine Regiment was already on its way to France, accompanied by the Army's new 1st Division, put together from elements of the 16th, 18th, 26th, and 28th Regiments. Once in France, the 1st moved to a training area around Gondrecourt, while the Marines, left to grumble in laborers' guards and stevedores at Brest, Saint-Nazaire, and other ports, wondered whether they would ever see action. The undersized army, meanwhile, faced the Herculean task of growing its numbers toward 1 million men through volunteers and a draft, which was to be held on June 5, 1917. The recruits and draftees would need housing, training, and outfitting, tasks that would take months and months to accomplish. To that end, 16 training camps were set up around the country to handle draftees and those who had enlisted in their local National Guards. Still, by the end of 1917, elements of just 4 American divisions, each of which would be double the size of an Allied division at 28,000 men, and consist of 4 regiments, 2 to each of 2 brigades, would be in France. Even as the gears were set in motion to build a huge army, almost from scratch, and the desperate and pleading French begged the United States to send men, men, and more men, the Marines had already set to work recruiting the best and the brightest to fill out the ranks of the 5th Regiment, as well as create a new regiment, the 6th. Promising a quick trip over there to whip the Hun, the Marines were inundated with eager applicants. The Corps opened recruiting stations across the country, and seeking top candidates flooded the nation's college campuses, including the University of Minnesota, where some 500 students enlisted as one on a single day. Half would go to the 6th Regiment's 78th Company, the other half to the 5th Regiment's 20th Company. They came as well from the Ivy League. Harvard football great Eddie Mahone, the original triple threat in running, kicking, and passing the ball, now lent his talents to the Corps. Harvard's rival, Yale, added baseball and football star Harry Lagour, the hockey star Holcomb York, the track star Johnny Overton, and the swimmer Lewis Ferguson. But the volunteers-only Marines were picky. Applicants had to be between 5'5" and 6'2" in height and weigh no more than 130 pounds. They also had to be at least 18 years old, but not older than 36. The Corps required that they be U.S. citizens, proficient in reading and writing English, unmarried and without dependents, and of good health, strong constitutions, well-formed, sound as to senses and limbs, and not addicted to the use of intoxicants or drugs. Some 80% of applicants overall were turned away for various reasons, physical or mental, and Catlin would one day boast that 60% of the 6th Regiment's men were college men, many of whom were quality physical specimens standing more than 6 feet tall. The American colleges doubtless supposed that they were turning men into scholars, Catlin would write with great mirth. When the test came, they found that they had been training soldiers. The Marines also sought quality officers to lead this mostly educated mob, and Barnett had ingeniously sent letters of inquiry to colleges and universities around the country, offering quick lieutenant commissions in the Marine Corps Reserve to top candidates. Candidates such as Cliff Cates, who applied, was accepted, and soon found himself on a life journey he could never have imagined or dreamed while growing up at bucolic Cates Landing, Tennessee. Prison Island. Marine Corps officer trainee Clifton Bledsoe Cates's first test of battle came not against some steel-jawed Hun operating a machine gun on some blood-drenched battlefield in France, but against a clenched-jawed Marine tyrant wielding his arbitrary pen in an office in Washington, D.C. Upon his acceptance as an officer candidate for the Marine Corps Reserve, the first order of business for Cates and other potential officers had been to take a physical. And it was while preparing for that seemingly routine procedure that Cates displayed his innate ability for leadership, an ability that would, in the coming months, bond him to his men, who would one day profess their willingness to follow him to the gates of hell, if that was where he might be headed. Told to report to the Marine Barracks in Washington, D.C. for a physical examination, he and some 200 other young officer candidates from all over the East Coast crowded the designated office at 9 a.m. on May 21, 1917, only to be told to come back at 1 p.m. But when they returned, they were rebuffed and told to return the next morning. They said, "Come back this afternoon at 1. Come back tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Come back in the afternoon at 1 o'clock," Cates would recall. That kept up for 3 days, and we were all running out of money. Finally, pockets empty, the fed-up would-be Marines decided to appoint a 3-man committee to go see the terrifying, intimidating, and very loud commanding officer, Major Dick Terrible Terry Williams. Cates was not only one of the 3 designated, but was quickly made the small group's spokesman. And when he appeared in Terrible Terry's office, he told the major in no uncertain terms that the whole lot of the boys were almost out of dough and would leave Washington and the Corps behind if they weren't examined that very day. Terrible Terry, of course, was almost apoplectic at Cates's college boy gall. He pounded the desk and said, "What the hell is this? Insubordination before you get into the Marine Corps? Get out of here," Cates would recall. Cates left, but as he went through the doorway, he turned and told Terrible Terry, "If we're not examined this afternoon, we're going back." The physicals were held that same afternoon. Cliff Cates had faced down Terrible Terry and lived. Cates passed his physical with flying colors, he would say later, though he had secretly quaked at the thought that the doctors would find something wrong with him as they poked and prodded and pummeled and thumped chests and backs, and then turned the recruits into human pincushions with a variety of inoculations. Marine recruit Lemuel Shepard, newly graduated from the Virginia Military Institute, was examined by Naval Captain Bobo DeSez, a rough, gruff old seagoing bull surgeon. Shepard, like Cates, worried he wouldn't pass. He weighed just 123 pounds, as he ran on the track team and was pretty thin in those days. DeSez looked him over, took his blood pressure, and then told Shepard, Get down over there and stick up your ass. Have you ever had a dose of the clap?
No, sir, Shepard replied.
Have you ever had piles?
No, sir.
You pass, DeSaz told him.
They certainly were rough with us, Cates would later write, but I didn't mind as long as we passed.
Cates and the others who passed were sworn in as second lieutenants in the Marine Corps Reserve, and Cliff then returned to his suddenly empty frat house in Knoxville, from which the boys had all fled into one branch or another of the service. It sure is sad to think that I may not ever get to see some of my frat brothers again, he would write. It was real pathetic telling them goodbye. He awaited further orders and in the meantime struggled to fulfill orders to procure certain property, including one suit of undress blue, 4 summer suits, a winter field coat, trousers and breeches, 6 pairs of white gloves, 1 pair of tan leather gloves, a belt, a watch, a compass, 2 or more flannel shirts, an overcoat, a scarf, a raincoat, 1 sword, its length, quality, and appearance not delineated. There were also shoes and leggings and caps and bedding rolls to be ordered from the depot of supplies in Philadelphia. 1,001 things, Cates would write. The final tally for his outfitting ran to $296. His monthly pay for the coming year would be $141.50. Well, he was in the Army now, or rather, the Marines, and what was to come would come. And he told himself he would bear it no matter what. He hoped soon enough to end the suspense as to exactly what that might be as he cooled his heels in Knoxville. The suspense ended when his orders arrived. He was to report with his baggage to Port Royal, South Carolina. I do not know whether I am glad to go or not, he would write on June 11th, on the eve of his departure from Knoxville. I have made a lot of friends here, and of course I hate to bid them goodbye. It is awful hard to tell anyone goodbye. I would rather just leave. I know that I can make good, he would later add in a letter to his mother, and someday you will be proud to call me your son. Cates arrived at Port Royal on June 13th. There, a ferry, just a scow, really, waited to transport him and a group of just-arrived recruits to a place called Paris Island, which, in the spring of 1917, housed a Marine detention center. With the coming of the Great War to America, the 8,000-square-acre spit of land became the primary recruit depot and training ground for those who had enlisted from places east of the Mississippi River, among them Cliff Cates. He had known the southern summer sun, but this was something else, something venal and insidious and vengeful. There was no way and nowhere to hide from its venomous rays, no escape from its baking sting, no respite from its exacting toll until nightfall. He had also known insects on the bottomlands along the Mississippi at Cates Landing, stinging, flying nightmare squads of flies and mosquitoes, and even contracted malaria as a youngster. But even those perfidies were no match for what he found at Paris Island. This is an awful place, Cliff Cates would write upon arrival. Just a dock and some houses. It's on a bay, but it's 15 miles from the coast. It is awful hot, and the mosquitoes and flies are awful. Paris Island was a vile, hot, level piece of land that the French had tried to settle way back in the 1500s, building a doomed and short-lived settlement known as Charlefort. Between the heat and the insects and the intrusions of the local Indians, the settlement had quickly gone kaput. In later years, it served as a naval base, as home to a handful of plantations run by hardier settlers than the French had been able to find, and then as a training ground for Marine officers. It would see thousands of newly minted Marines pass through in 1917 and 1918, and some of those who survived the training and then the ordeals of battle in France would later in life look back in misery and wonderment at what one recruit would refer to as his prison island. In 1917, it was almost a wilderness with just a few isolated plantation homes, but no roads, no barracks, no latrines capable of handling thousands of men at a time, and no truly fresh drinking water. It was hell on earth, and it was intended to be just that.
a place where under the sadistic watch of veteran non-coms, boys became men, and then with any luck, Marines. Recruits who would mostly fill the 6th Regiment were greeted at the island's dock by a jeering crowd of those who had come before, some just the day before, but after 24 hours in the place, one already considered oneself a veteran. Get your silk pajamas over here. This way for your ice cream. Get your white sheets over here, the cynical, heat-crazed bastards would sing. And then the neophytes would be hustled through a gauntlet of sadists who thumped them with rolled-up newspapers, rubber hoses, and other handy tools of torture, as one would remember. The next day, the fun would begin. They drilled. They built barracks. They dug an extensive latrine system. They drilled, and drilled some more under the blazing and unforgiving sun. They ate foul-smelling eggs, potatoes boiled in brackish water, rancid fried fatback, and hair-raising salty black coffee. Fare they called hen fruit, spuds, punk, piss, and sow belly. They endured as well as they could. As one recruit remembered, "The first day I was at camp, I was afraid I was going to die. My next 2 weeks, my sole fear was that I wasn't going to die." They were also introduced to colorful characters, long-serving Marines sent to the new regiment to imbue them in the Marine traditions. One old-timer Marine, drunk as a skunk, lurched into Private Levi Hemrick's 50-man tent on Hemrick's first night on the island, pulled a whopping big pistol out of his belt, and pointed it, slowly, at each recruit. Satisfied he had the men's attention, he reeled to a table and faced his audience. Suddenly, he banged on the table with the butt of the pistol and began to harangue us on the virtue and history of the Marine Corps, boasting of his own exploits and acts of heroism, Hemrick wrote. We couldn't tell for sure whether he was actually drunk, acting out a Wild West barroom scene, or just showing his true nature under the influence of alcohol. Hemrick, a former principal in a rural school in Panthersville, Georgia, was shocked and wondered what he'd gotten himself into. Was this drunken slouch the real Marine? He would write. Was the poster in Atlanta and the recruiting officer's talk just window dressing to lure fellows like me into the Corps? Was this just another phase of our initiation to boot camp? These and other painful thoughts plagued me as the old fella ended his thick-tongued lecture and lurched out of the tent. In the coming weeks, the recruits drilled under the hot sun, went on long hikes with full packs, hauled arm-busting oyster shells from the beach to pave new camp roads, and did their laundry daily in buckets. Their wash was then inspected, and even if clean, was sometimes thrown into the muddy street by their superiors, who told them their clothes were not clean enough, and instructed them to wash them again. After a month of such labors and indignities, they moved to the rifle range and learned to become marksmen, the Marines especially prizing their abilities on the rifle range. They continued to kvetch and complain and wonder if they'd made the worst mistake of their lives. But lo and behold, at the end of 10 weeks, the hard work melted the fat from the overlarge belt lines and replaced lumps of fat with bulging muscles, Hemrick wrote. By the 3rd week, many of the men noticed they were being physically transformed, hardened. Their sooty feller white skins were turning golden. What was flab had turned to sinuous muscle. Their once soft college boy brains had somehow endured the petty tortures of their vengeful Svengali sergeants, and they learned they could take it. I knew I would never die because I had become so hard that nothing could kill me, one recruit would conclude. The lanky and underweight, as I, took on from 15 to 25 pounds, most of it going into broadening of the shoulders, hardening the arm and leg muscles, Levi Hemrick would write. In the end, each recruit underwent a change that indicated development of physical power, firmness, determination and boldness, a fighting man's image. They were Marines. Almost. Cliff Cates did not dwell on the privations of Prison Island. He simply noted that he had been issued a small tent and had to run around and get blankets, gun, buckets, chair, and etc. He would remember his time there as consisting mainly of work on the rifle range, a luxury afforded those with commissions, but not the average recruit. In any event, while the enlisted men went through their 10 weeks of torture, Cates and the other trainee officers in early July were moved off the island, and after receiving leave were sent to a new destination, a 6,000-acre camp being built adjacent to Quantico, Virginia, up the Atlantic coast, another brand-new sprawling training ground where the recruits would eventually be formed into companies, battalions, and finally a regiment, the 6th. The town of Quantico looked just like pictures of mining towns I had seen. Second Lieutenant James McBrayer Sellers, a Missourian whose father was president of the Wentworth Military Academy in Lexington, Missouri, would remember. There was one small street which constituted the original town. The street led right up from the pier. Then there were rows and rows of unpainted wooden shacks, sprung up almost literally overnight. Downtown, there were little restaurants where we could get an egg sandwich for 50 cents. And there was also a dance hall where they charged 20 cents for a dance with one of the painted ladies brought to town for the purpose. They had other purposes as well, among them servicing the thousands of construction workers who were busy throwing up barracks and other buildings. Anticipating the arrival of thousands of recruits and the manly temptations they would bring with them, Base Commander John A. Lejeune ordered the painted ladies to hit the bricks. Second Lieutenant William A. Wharton drew the job of rounding up the ladies and sending them packing, and dutifully arrived at 10 a.m. on a quiet Tuesday morning to do the job. After having the 100 or so women line up in the town's dirty street, he handed out train fares to Washington, D.C. But as they were about to board the train, one old-time sergeant whispered in the ear of one of the prostitutes. Then, about 6 of them came over and kissed me goodbye, Wharton recalled, and they all waved and so forth to me. God. The mortified young officer marched his detail back to Lejeune's adjutant, William T. Hoadley, who'd heard all about the overly friendly send-off. Somebody told me they were kissing you right and left, he told Wharton. You been running down there and looking these girls over every night? Wharton remained quiet. Inside, he was furious at the insinuation. As at Paris Island, where his so-called officer training mainly consisted of time on the rifle range, Cates poo-pooed the value of the regimen and would later say he spent at least half of his time in trying to learn the semaphore and the Morse code, and what good was that for a second lieutenant? And of course, we had lots of close-order drill. We had some extended order drill, and we dug trenches and threw dummy grenades, and some of the training was good, but a lot of it wasn't worth much. I would say that at least half of it wasn't worth a hurrah. Officer training began on July 30th and was supposed to last 3 months. Rising at 5:45 a.m., the men did physical drills at 6, usually consisting of little more than racing for half a mile through the rough streets of Quantico. Breakfasted at 6:30 a.m., drilled from 7:30 a.m. to 9 a.m., and then drilled and studied until 10 p.m. when they turned in. There was some time for some fun, too. James Sellers would remember Cates as being quite a craps player, one time taking $3,000 from one colonel's cowardly translator, Sidney Colford, the camp clown whose main job was to find liquor for the old colonel. When Colford offered Cates an IOU for the sum, Clifford tried to sell the note to others for 3 cents on the dollar, with no luck. However, after the war, Colford married a wealthy Vanderbilt divorcee, so the IOU was good, Sellers remembered. I wished I had bought it from Cliff when I had the chance. Lucky Cliff Cates. The laconic Cates was popular with the other officers, but he did not immediately endear himself to his future battalion commander, Major Thomas Holcomb, a 17-year veteran of the Corps, during their time at Quantico. The 38-year-old Holcomb had spent years in China with the Corps and was renowned as a crack shot with a rifle. He had been married to the Corps only until the previous year when he wed 21-year-old Washington debutante Beatrice Clover. He was now faced with his first combat command, and he and Cates would become close during the coming trials.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.